Hello and welcome back. I'm Gavin. This is my channel. It's been quite a long time since I talked to you the last time, over a month and a half. But I have to say, I really needed the time to rest. Getting COVID really knocked me on my backside, and it took me weeks after I was officially over COVID to even feel like myself. And I know it's not the best thing for my YouTube channel to go a month and a half without a video, but so far this year, I've made 58 videos on my channel. So that's about 1.5 a week on average. So thank you for understanding while I've been recuperating and taking a bit of a break. You guys have been nothing but understanding and encouraging, so thank you for that. Also, a special thank you goes out to my patrons who give me their hard-earned dollars every month. You guys are just awesome. And in addition to that, I had a couple people reach out through the contact page on my website asking if they could help me by offsetting some of the costs that I've incurred by having to hire an attorney, you know, to respond to that letter from the attorney for the Goldberg family and the Schwartzman family that they sent me back in August. So at their suggestion, I put my tip jar page back up on the website for them, and they have been very generous. Seriously, I can't thank those people enough. You know who you are, and you are amazing. Thank you very much. Okay, as we get into this case that I'll be covering today, I feel like I need to tell you a little bit of the background on how I learned about this case. And this video, by the way, is part one of three. But months ago, I was at the gym with Kimberly, and I know I don't strike you as the kind of guy that works out, but I do sometimes. And one of the guys at the gym that's always there came up to me and told me that he found out about my YouTube channel. And this guy, who's been around these parts for ages and was at one point a newspaper reporter for the local newspaper, he told me about a murder case that's 52 years old that happened just a few blocks down the street from where we live, on my street. And the case is so interesting and is one that can teach us a lot, but I hemmed and hawed about doing any research on it because, I mean, it happened on my street. So telling you about this case would kind of let the cat out of the bag as far as letting you know where I live. And while I love to invite you to come and hang out with me on YouTube, I haven't been all that thrilled or enthusiastic about people maybe showing up at my house. And that actually has happened. So I hope you guys can understand that I've been a little bit apprehensive about doing this case for that reason. But I mean, I'm writing for the local publication now and people see me. So I kind of feel like I might as well. So as I was kind of thinking about this, just a few weeks ago, I was listening to an episode of the Catch My Killer podcast, and they were talking about this case. The guest on the podcast was a woman named Wendy, and she told the story of this victim, who it turned out was her dad's first wife, not her mom, but her dad's first wife, who her dad had children with, so she has these half-siblings, right? So her dad, you know, got remarried, later had Wendy with his second wife. Anyway, he talked about his former wife during her childhood and always wanted to know who was responsible for his first wife's murder. Turns out that their relationship was one of those where he still loved her and wanted the best for her, but marriage just wasn't working out. But then, a few months after they were divorced, she was killed. Wendy went on to say that for years, when she'd come back to this area, she would go to the local libraries and research the case by going through their old archives. And she said she didn't have much luck going through those newspaper microfilms and microfiche. What's the plural of microfiche? Anyway, she didn't have very much luck But I thought, well, you know what? I can do that. I'm actually very good at it and I'm here. So it's very easy for me to do it. And I kind of have a knack, or maybe even what could be described as a drive, to dig into these old cases. This one's 52 years old, but that's where I started on my true crime YouTube journey. My first case, Judy Hockery, was from the same time period. So I thought maybe it would be unpopular being an older case, but it became important to me. It's my hometown. It became important to me, so I decided to dig in. But let me just pause and reiterate this one thing to you guys, because it's important to me. I'm really glad that you watch these videos. I'm glad that you subscribe and comment and share and, you know, click the like button. But please, if you do some, you know, sleuthing of your own to find out where I live, please don't show up at my house, okay? Even if you're local, please just don't. But if you see me out of the park or walking the dog or, I don't know, back to school night, I'd love to stop and chat with you. Just please don't show up at my home. That's kind of our sacred space, right? Okay. When I started to dig into the case, the first place I went was to the newspaper archives. I know from looking into old cases like Judy Hockery, like Carol Beth Hilburn, like Nancy Benalik, that the relationship that journalists had with law enforcement, especially in small towns, was very different back then than it is now. I would say that law enforcement was more liberal in the amount of information that they would give to the press. And I mean, not to give too much away that happens later in the story, but when this case goes to trial, the newspapers published everything, like even the names and addresses and occupations of the jurors that were selected, and they published it for everybody to see. So anyway, knowing that this was kind of the way it was back then, that's where I started. And I ended up finding 147 newspaper articles about the murder and the cold case, or the court case. And yeah, this went to court. No, it's not solved. It's cold. So the next thing I did was head down to the Venango County Courthouse in Franklin, Pennsylvania, which is where this case takes place. And I searched the archive of the Clerk of Courts and the Prothonotary. That office, by the way, in Venango County is full of extremely helpful people. And so with their help, I found 59 documents about the case. Pretty great. So just to let you know, all of the newspaper clippings and the court documents that I found have been posted to my website, gavinfish.com. You can find them there. After visiting Venango County, the next thing I did was reach out by telephone to Clearfield County, to their Clerk of Courts, and ask the same thing that I asked the Clerk of Courts in Venango County. And the reason I did that is because this case had a change of venue once it went to trial, so documents are spread out all over the place. When I called Clearfield County and told them what I was looking for, they gave me an email address to send my request to. I promptly emailed in and got a response back a couple days later, which told me that they don't do those kinds of searches for private citizens. They said they only do it for government agencies. Confused, I called back and talked to the deputy prothonotary, who basically told me to just go pound sand. And then she full on hung up on me. I couldn't believe it. And I'm not a rude person. I was just very confused at how this person would misunderstand the law that badly. But anyway, I think I'm getting off track. So let me just say that whole experience caused me to write an article in the publication that I work for all about the crappy law that is the Pennsylvania right to know law, and the fact that its predecessor was even worse, and that many government employees out here in our area still think that they're living under the original law. I'll link to that article in the description below if you want to read it. But long story short, after explaining to the prothonotary what had happened with one of his employees, he offered to make it right. So if they do have those files, I probably won't get them for a long time, but when I get them, or if I get them, I will put them up on the website. So if you're watching this video when it comes out, those files won't be there, but if I get them, I'll put them there. So if you're watching this video sometime in the future, they might already be there by now. The next thing I did, or let's say this is the last thing I did as I was gathering information for this case, is I shot a couple of emails and I followed up with a phone call, left a voicemail with our local district attorney asking if he'd be willing to share their old file with me. Their file, the prosecution's file, would include all sorts of investigative stuff that would have never been in the newspapers, nor would it have been in the court documents. Now, time will tell if DA Sean White gets back to me. Technically, he doesn't have to disclose those files under the right to know law, but there's also nothing in the law that is legally preventing him from doing it. And I think he might be open to it, especially since everybody involved in this case is already dead, not just our victim. So if I get those documents, I will go through them, scan them, organize them, put them on the website as well. Okay, so now with that giant introduction out of the way, which I shared with you partly so that you know I really haven't been taking a break. It just looks like I have, but let's get into the details of the 1972 murder of Janie Manning. So our victim in this case is a 36-year-old divorced mother of five, Cyrena Jane Manning. Janie is what people called her. The newspapers described her as a, quote, recent divorcee when her life was taken on November 20th, 1972. And I really don't know what qualified as recent back then. I did some digging trying to find her marriage records, her divorce records, and I haven't been able to find them yet. The only thing I found in that search was a marriage certificate for her husband's second marriage, which took place in August of 1972. And I'm not sure what their separation looked like or even when they got divorced. All I have is recent divorcee. And her ex-husband, who would be Wendy's dad, his name was Cecil Manning, he died in 2013. Now, in the newspapers, Janie's five children were all named. And I'm not going to do that in these videos, even though we're 50 years on, with the exception of her oldest daughter, who was 17 at the time. And I'll get to her because it's important to the case. I don't know what the ages were of all of the other children, but I do know that they were all in school at the time of Janie's murder. So 17 years old down to no less than 5 years old, let's say. All of the children, according to the early reports in the paper, were living with their mother. And the marriage certificate I found for Cecil was from the state of Virginia. So I don't know if Cecil was even in the picture at this point. I'm not sure. But anyway, Janie and her five kids lived in a small, what is described as a 2.5-story home at 804 Elk Street in Franklin, Pennsylvania. This is my adopted hometown. Now this house, when we go look at it, is a very northeastern style home. It's narrow and tall. They call them 2.5 stories because the attic is usually finished off. This house has a steep roof with dormers coming off of the sides. It's a very typical house for this area here in Western Pennsylvania. And I need to describe the street, the street on the block that Janie lived on, because it becomes important later on when we talk about what witnesses saw. So at the point on Elk Street, it's a one-way street, and 804 is two houses up from the intersection of Elk Street and 8th Street. 8th Street is, at that point, actually US Route 322, which is a route that goes through Ohio, through Pennsylvania, all the way to the New Jersey shore. It's not to say that it's a big intersection, but by the standards of this town, I'd call it a busy intersection. And I don't know if there was a stoplight at the time like there is now, but the way it's set up, there's a left-hand turning lane that starts right in front of 804. And because it's a narrow one-way street, there's no parking allowed in front of the house. Parking on that side of the street really starts in front of her next door neighbor's house, which is 806. And none of the first few houses on that side of the block have garages that I can see. So they would have parked their cars on the street if they had them. And again, this may seem like too much information, but I'm telling you, it becomes important later on. Okay, back to Janie. By all accounts, she was a normal mom, with the exception maybe that in 1972, she was a divorced mother of five. But she belonged to a local church, St. John's Episcopal Church, which is only about a 2 or 3 minute drive from her house. She belonged to the local Moose Lodge, just another couple blocks up from St. John's. She was a Cub Scout den mother to her two boys. And I can just picture, I can see it in my mind, Janie Manning in her 1970s yellow den mother shirt, which just kind of reminds me of my mom and the other moms in our community when I was a little kid. Janie, I guess, was like them. And the other thing about Janie is that she worked two jobs. One as a cook at the commercial hotel and restaurant in Franklin. Now, locals are going to have to help me out on this. I haven't been able to find where the commercial hotel and restaurant was. I suspect it's now called the Quality Inn on Liberty Street. Quality Inn looks like it was built before 1972, but again, I'm not sure. So if you're local and you know, please go ahead and put it in the comments below. Janie's second job was in the housekeeping department at the Franklin Hospital. The hospital at the time was located across French Creek from downtown Franklin where she lived and was kind of up on the hill, easily within driving distance after just maybe a few minutes. So with that information in mind, I think we can all understand what life was probably like for Janie Manning. She was a busy, working two jobs to take care of five kids mother who was recently divorced, whatever recently means, right? So it looked like she was trying to be active in her kids' lives, and she was also trying to have some sort of social life as well. On the morning of Monday, November 20th, 1972, it started out as a normal day for her family. The kids got up, had their breakfast, and were out the door nice and early to get to school. I think at that time, the elementary school was within walking distance to her house. Her older kids would have had to either drive or taken the bus up to the middle and high schools. But anyway, they got up early and they headed out to school. Now, from this point on, I'm going to tell the story as it was told in the newspapers, in the order it was told in the newspapers, because I think laying it out chronologically this way, the same way that reporters told it, is going to help us understand what the people in town were thinking, what they were hearing about this case. Keep in mind that when Janie Manning was killed, it was the first murder in Franklin in 11 years. It just didn't happen very often back then, and it still doesn't happen very often in Franklin. It's mostly a quiet town. Now, at 11:20 a.m. that morning, a neighbor two doors down from Janie's house, a woman named Marion Mortimer, and she was in the direction away from the intersection. So she was two doors down the other way in the opposite direction of the one-way traffic. She saw this Marion Mortimer, the neighbor, saw a man walking from the direction of Janie's house. She saw him get into a car that she described as blue with a black top and had an Ohio license plate. And then she said he drove off. She said she recognized him as, quote, Mrs. Manning's boyfriend from Ohio. Boyfriend was written out in the newspapers with a space between the boy and friend. I'm not sure if that was just the style guide the paper used back then, or if writing it that way meant something different as writing it with the two words together. I don't know. But that's what she said. Her husband, a guy named James Mortimer, and his name was reported three different ways in the newspapers over the course of the case. It was reported as James, J.D., and J.E. I haven't been able to find any obituary or anything, so I don't know what it was. I'm just going to call him Mr. Mortimer probably for the rest of these videos. But anyway, he added to his wife's testimony that the license plate number on that blue car with a black top was, quote, G322-something. Keep in mind the parking situation that I told you about earlier. With all the residents parking on the street, this man's first available parking spot was probably right in front of Marion and Mr. Mortimer's house. Now, about that same time, Janie Manning's dog started howling and wouldn't stop. The neighbors were used to the dog barking and could usually get it to stop by calling to it over the fence, but on this day, it was a howl, not a bark, and it wouldn't stop. Mr. Mortimer said he called out to the dog three or four times, and after tiring of the noise, walked over to Janie's house to hush the dog. But it didn't work. So he decided to go knock on the door, probably hoping Janie would get the dog to stop howling. When he went up on the porch, which today is the entire width of the house, though in newspaper photos of the house from back then, it was a small porch. He went up on the porch and he knocked on the door. She did not answer the door. He then said he looked in the front window, so he would have had to come down from the porch and gone up to the front window of the house. And when he peeked in, he saw what he thought was Janie Manning having fainted and passed out on the floor of her kitchen in the back of the house. Now, not wanting to do anything improper or untoward, Mr. Mortimer went back to the house, hit to his house, and told Marion what he'd seen. She then went across the street to 805 Elk Street and got a neighbor. Those two ladies then crossed back over the street, went up on the porch, and turned the handle on the front door. And they found that it was unlocked. They entered, went through the front room into the kitchen, and immediately saw that Janie Manning was lying in a pool of blood. Marion then called out to her husband and told him what they'd found. He then yelled out to another neighbor to call for an ambulance, and that is what that neighbor did. Marion Mortimer said the only thing that she or the other neighbor touched, other than the front door handle, was Janie's dress. She said it was up around her upper body, and so Marion pulled it down to cover her up. It's unclear to me the order of events over the next few minutes just because of the way that it was reported. But I think that an ambulance probably arrived and saw that Janie Manning was dead. So they then called the police. Again, this is just a guess. I really don't know. What I do know from the police report is that they were called at 11:56 p.m., about, let's say, 25 minutes or so after Marion Mortimer and the other neighbor found Janie. Now, this next part, it's going to become important once we get into the trial, okay? Police, after finding that Janie Manning was dead and suspecting foul play, made two phone calls. The first was to the coroner's office. And the coroner who arrived on scene was actually a deputy coroner named Edward W. Gabrice. At least I think that's how you pronounce his name. And that's how I'm going to be pronouncing it from here on. The second call that they made was to a freelance photographer who they hired to come and take photos of the crime scene. It turns out they didn't have their own crime scene photographer on staff, probably because they just didn't need that full-time employee. So this guy that they'd contract with to take photos was a reporter for the local newspaper, the Franklin News Herald. It was a guy named Fran Fry Jr. And what's kind of funny about this, so he's a guy who was on scene at the crime scene, but what's funny about this is that Mr. Fry is one of the reporters that continued to cover the case for more than 2 years and was even a prosecution witness when the case finally went to trial. In fact, he covered the trial for the News Herald on the very day that he took the witness stand. I find that bizarre, just absolutely weird. But those are the two calls that police made. Deputy Coroner Gabrice, it turns out that he recognized Janie Manning. It's a small town, but even then, he knew Janie because he worked at the Franklin Hospital as a laboratory technician. Janie, as we already know, worked in housekeeping. So he came to the scene. He ordered an autopsy of his coworker and said he witnessed the autopsy as well. And that autopsy started at 1 p.m. the same day, just about an hour after police first arrived at Janie Manning's house at 804 Elk Street. They were moving quickly, probably because this sort of thing didn't happen very often and they had plenty of bandwidth when such a terrible crime, you know, would occur. So Mr. Fry took photos of the scene before and after Janie's body was removed. And these are some of the details of the scene that he shared in his reports. The front room of the house was kind of a combination living room and dining room. There was a round table that had several chairs around it. None of the reports or stories that I read say how many chairs, but what they do say is that everything seemed to be in its place with a minor exception of two of the dining chairs around the table being slightly askew. On the table, there was a coffee mug with a small amount of coffee in it. Next to the mug, Janie's Bible lay open to Deuteronomy, and police noted that the chapter that it was open to talked about, quote, crimes against marriage. So that's a little bit weird. Next to her Bible, there was a dictionary, and I took that to mean that maybe Janie was studying the Bible and looking up words that she didn't understand. Reports never mention if the Bible was open, and if it was, what page it was open to. It never says anything about it. It just says that there was a dictionary there. The last thing on the table, probably the most important thing, was a small white piece of paper with a handwritten note on it. And Janie's daughter later said that it definitely wasn't her mother's handwriting, so it was written by somebody else. The note read, quote, golden rule, stab in the back. Let's just leave that one hanging there for a second. The Bible open to Deuteronomy, the note that says golden rule, stab in the back. This is like something right out of a Stieg Larsson novel. I kind of wish, knowing what's going to happen in this case, that it was a Stieg Larsson novel with Lisbeth and Mikhail solving the crime. But no, it was a group of 1970s Franklin, Pennsylvania police officers who hadn't seen a murder in over a decade, which of course is not their fault at all. But their lack of experience is definitely going to come into play in this case, and it's going to become a real problem, which I will get into. Now, getting back to Deputy Coroner Gabrice, when he was on scene, he said he thought that Janie had been shot 3 times in the lower abdomen and in the back. Her wounds, he said, were shaped funny. But once the pathologist took a look, he concluded that she was actually stabbed, and it was believed that the weapon used by her assailant was a pair of kitchen scissors that were kept on a windowsill above the kitchen sink. One of the children told police that she saw the scissors in the morning before she left for school in their place, but they weren't anywhere to be seen at the crime scene. Police later said they thought that maybe she had been stabbed while seated at the round table and that her body was then moved into the kitchen. And I have to say, if that were the case, then it took a lot of chutzpah on the part of the assailant. I mean, all of these houses have kind of big windows on the front. And if you were to do what police thought was done, it would have been in front of a window for the entire neighborhood to see. And I mean, Mr. Mortimer testified that he looked in the window, so we know that it wasn't covered. Police also said there weren't any signs of a struggle or forced entry, and there was a pot of tea that had been made that was still on the stove. So with that in mind, they felt that Janie knew her attacker. It was somebody that she was close to, maybe a boyfriend. While they were on scene, they took fingerprints off of the coffee cup and a few other places, but they did not say at this point whose prints they found. But it didn't take long for police to identify the man that Marion Mortimer described as Mrs. Manning's boyfriend from Ohio. The man's name was Frank Howard Sidlowski. And by the way, I wouldn't name Mr. Sidlowski in this video under normal circumstances, let's say. But in this case, he is dead and has been for decades. And he also stood trial for Janie's murder, so it's all very public record. So yeah, I'm comfortable. I'm going to be using his name. Frank was a 56-year-old welder from Brookfield, Ohio. That puts him at 20 years older than Janie Manning. Now, Brookfield is a town in Ohio about an hour away from Franklin. And he was in town working as a construction worker on the expansion of Route 8 south of Franklin. And this is actually one of those things that is interesting to maybe only to me. It surprised me when we moved out here. Route 8 intersects with Interstate 80. And at the intersection on the south side, it's just a 2-lane highway. But once it crosses 80 and you start going up toward Franklin, it splits into a very, very big, very nice highway that's way bigger than is necessary to get to our little town. But at the time, Franklin and the surrounding area, which is known as Oil Heritage Area, was at kind of the tail end of an oil boom that had been going on since 1859. Though, of course, at the time, they didn't know that the boom would be over within 20 years or so. Franklin at the time was the county seat and the hub of commerce. And so because of all this activity in the area because of all the money coming through town, because it was the county seat. There were just a lot of rich people here, and there was a lot of oil being moved out of here. It's one of the reasons why we love the town. It's got tons of beautiful architecture, tons of big Victorian mansions. So it's something else. If you ever want to tour Western Pennsylvania and see something really beautiful, you've got to come to the Franklin Oil City area. It's absolutely beautiful. Anyway, I really got off on a tangent there. Route 8 was being expanded basically into what it is today, and Frank was one of the workers who made that happen. Frank met Janie at the commercial hotel. Again, she was working there as a cook, one of her two jobs, and he was staying there because he was working from out of town. But shortly after they met, Frank moved into Janie's house. And we're going to get into that in just a minute. But first, let me just say, Frank had left Franklin. Man, my tongue is going to get tied on this. But Frank left Franklin somewhere between 2 and 4 weeks prior to Janie's death. He was back in Brookfield, Ohio. I guess the job was done. So when Franklin PD was told about seeing him by neighbors and then Janie's kids telling them about him, they thought that was a solid lead and decided that they had to go to Ohio. So later that day, we're still on November 20th, 1972, the day that Janie Manning was killed, officers from the Franklin Police Department went to the Trumbull County Sheriff's Office, Trumbull County being the county that Brookfield is in Ohio. And then from there, they went with those sheriff's deputies to Frank's house on Bedford Road. And that was literally his entire address. Frank Sidlowski, Bedford Road, Brookfield, Ohio. It was the only house there. And it was a small house on a large piece of property, large-ish, wasn't like hundreds of acres or anything, but it was a big piece of property and it had a barn-style garage on it. So they go up to the house, they knock on the door, and the person who answered was Frank's wife, Caroline, who went by Grace. And I guess that struck me that her name was Caroline and she went by Grace because two of our daughters share those names. Grace Sidlowski, by the way, died at the age of 96 back in 2012. So anyway, when Grace answered the door and told police that she was Frank's wife, they were kind of taken aback. They didn't expect her to be there. But being the professionals that they were, they invited Frank to the Trumbull County Sheriff's Station to talk to them formally. Frank accepted their invitation and met up with investigators there later that day. And his wife, Grace, went with him. Now, the reason they didn't expect Grace to be at the house is because Janie's children had told them that Frank had said that he was a widower. He said his wife had died in childbirth years before, which begs the question, what was the relationship between Janie Manning and Frank Sidlowski? Well, in his interview with investigators, he claimed that he was a boarder. He said that he paid Mrs. Manning $37.50 a week for room and board. He said he worked the evening shift out on Route 8, that he'd eat breakfast and lunch at Mrs. Manning's house. Then she or one of the girls would pack him a dinner to take with him to the job site. Now, Janie's children painted a different story. And as I've said before in other videos, the best lies are partly true. The children did say that he did eat at the house, breakfast and lunch, and that they would pack his dinner for him, but that he wasn't a boarder unless sleeping in the same bed as their mom qualified him as a boarder. In fact, people all around Franklin knew that Frank and Janie were in a romantic relationship. Janie's family knew too. He was her boyfriend. No space between the boy and friend. They even had a joint bank account together at the Pennsylvania Bank and Trust Company in town. So theirs was definitely an intimate relationship, though we find out it was rocky. And wouldn't you know it, they had broken off their relationship about the time Frank went back to Ohio 2 to 4 weeks prior to Janie's death. So back in the interview with Frank at the Trumbull County Sheriff's Station, Frank was denying all of this. He said he knew Janie Manning, yes, but he was just a boarder there. And when his job ended, he came back to his wife and to the area where his two grown married sons lived. But there were a few things that in the course of that interview, even though Frank was kind of telling stories, that investigators learned that that I guess were important to the case. First, Frank was known in Franklin to have long hair, but the day they saw him, which was the day that Janie was killed, it was short, and he told them that he cut it off that day. Second, they found out that Frank had gone by 6 names over the years. He was legally Frank Sedlowski, but he was born Frank Shadowski, and at various times he'd gone by Frank Reed, Frank Lasky, Frank Solasky, and Frank Salasky. The third thing they learned is that Frank did not have a blue car with a black top, but as they interviewed him, they learned that he had been in a fender bender the day before, one day before Janie Manning's murder, and had taken his car to an auto body shop. And when they found that shop, they found a blue 1968 Chevrolet with a black vinyl top that had Ohio license plate number G322E. And then they learned in talking with the shop owner that Frank had rented the car from him that day. So police impounded the car, they dusted it for fingerprints and searched for other evidence. So the mound of evidence is piling up. I mean, it's piling on top of Frank. The lies about his relationship with Janie and the fact that his wife and sons were alive and well. The joint bank account, the blue car with the black top, the aliases, the haircut that day. Investigators had enough to get arrest and search warrants. So that evening back in Franklin, a murder complaint was written up and was issued against Frank Sedlowski. And then the following day, a warrant was issued for his arrest. So the next day, investigators showed up at Frank's house. I'm sure he was like, oh, I'm in the clear here. But investigators showed up at Frank's house and served him first a search warrant. That happened at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. They searched his house and his garage, and the evidence they found is unclear. But then at 5 p.m., as Frank was having dinner with Grace, he was arrested for the murder of Janie Manning, and he was taken and booked into the Trumbull County Jail. Investigators had a problem, though, that it appears to me anyway, they hadn't faced in recent memory. Janie's murder happened in Franklin, Pennsylvania, but Frank lived in Brookfield, Ohio, and had been booked into jail there. So Frank had to be extradited back to Pennsylvania before he could be arraigned, indicted, and tried. His first court appearance was an arraignment to face extradition. This happened on November 24th, 1972. So we're 4 days past the murder of Janie Manning. Coincidentally, that was also the same day that they held Janie's funeral at the Episcopal Church. Now, Frank fought the extradition. He pleaded innocent. At least that's how the papers report it. He probably pleaded not guilty. But Frank was ordered to be held without bail until the extradition papers, which had to be signed by the governors of both the state of Pennsylvania and the state of Ohio, were filed. But then, on the 14th of December, just a few weeks after he was arrested, a municipal judge in Ohio released Frank from jail, saying that he was unconvinced that Frank was actually a fugitive in Pennsylvania. And I mean, I guess I understand why. It's because there wasn't any documentation to prove that Pennsylvania was trying to get him into custody. And why? Well, the district attorney back in Franklin, a guy named Miles R. Lynn, said that papers were sent to, quote, several wrong places in Harrisburg, which is the capital of Pennsylvania. I guess it wasn't that often that district attorney from podunk little Franklin, Pennsylvania would have to do this, so I guess we have to give him a little latitude. When the papers finally got to the governor's office, it turned out that the governor, Milton Schaap, was out of the country, so they had to wait for him to return. And once he did, he signed the papers. It was actually Christmas Day, and then he sent them back to D.A. Lynn a couple of days later. Then the papers were sent to the Ohio governor, a guy named John J. Gilligan, who finally signed them on the 5th of January. So by that time, another 3 weeks had passed. And Frank wasn't arrested on that day. He actually wasn't arrested again until January 9th, but at this time, he was arrested on a governor's warrant. All the paperwork was in order, it seems. So Frank was finally arraigned on the 19th of January, and three Franklin police officers plus Marion Mortimer made the trip out to Trumbull County to testify at the arraignment. So Frank was extradited to Franklin later that day, where he faced yet another arraignment, this time in front of Magistrate Robert E. Billingsley. A preliminary hearing was set for 10 days later, and bail was set at a whopping, in 1973 now, $85,000. And then he was booked into the Venango County Jail. Now here's the thing. By this point in time, it had been almost exactly 2 months since Janie Manning was murdered in her home at 804 Elk Street. Frank, at this point, had gone through two arrests and two arraignments, and there had been a total of three warrants issued in the case. I think there were three arraignments. So two arrests, three arraignments, and there were three warrants issued in the case. And police had a strong case against their suspect. Again, they had the lies that he told about his relationship with Janie, and the lies he told about the fact that his wife and sons were alive and well. They had the joint bank account. They had the blue car with the black vinyl top with the Ohio license plate number G322E. They had a witness that put him at the scene of the crime. They had the suspicious behavior, right? The aliases and the haircut. And while there had been a snafu or two about the extradition paperwork, things appeared to be going the police's way. They had their guy. They were convinced it was him. But they forgot one thing, one tiny little detail that they didn't consider. And it was going to grow into a major point of contention once Frank's lawyers really got involved. And it was this. Back on the day that Franklin police officers, along with Trumbull County Sheriff's deputies, invited Frank back to the sheriff's station for a voluntary interview, they did not advise him of his rights under Miranda v. Arizona. They did not Mirandize him. And you guys know what's in the Miranda warning, right? They did not tell him that he could remain silent. They did not tell him that anything he said in their interview could have been used against him. They didn't say that he could consult with an attorney and had the right to have that attorney present with him while he was being questioned with police. They didn't advise him that if he couldn't afford an attorney, that one would be appointed for him. They didn't tell him that he could stop answering questions at any time. And they did not verify by asking him if he knew and understood his rights and was still willing to answer their questions without an attorney present. And listen, guys, this was 1972. Miranda v. Arizona was decided by the U.S. Supreme Court in 1966, 6 years prior to Janie's death. Police were drilled on this decision, and I mean, they still are to this day. And everything, I mean, everything they found or discovered in Ohio as a result of that interview is going to end up subject to a motion for suppression by Frank's attorneys. And Frank's attorney, at least in my view, and you guys know that I love good lawyering, he is an absolute beast. And that's where I'm going to end today's video. Thank you so much for sticking around to the end. Parts 2 and 3 in this series are going to be up soon. In fact, I'm filming all 3 parts today. So you won't have to wait a month and a half to see how this all ends. Please remember that all of my sources for this video are up on my website. Just go to gavinfish.com, click on cases, then click on Cyrena Jane Manning. And like I said before, if I get more docs from Clearfield County or the Venango County District Attorney, I'll post those as well. If you guys happen to see my appearance on Investigation Discovery's Still a Mystery episode, the one on Rochelle Brinson, I'd love to know what you thought of it. Please post your comments below. I'm always open to constructive criticism, but please do so in a spirit of kindness and wanting to help me improve. I am getting calls from other producers pretty often these days, and I'd really like to not come off as an absolute idiot when I decide to participate in a production or two. So I would love that constructive criticism. Thank you so much to those of you who support my work by sharing, subscribing, commenting, clicking the like button, and all of that stuff. It goes a long way to getting my videos, my content in front of others who share our passion for solving cold cases. And once again, a huge shout out to my patrons. Thank you for your support. And if you are not a patron of mine and want to support me financially, please check out my Patreon page, which is linked below. Don't forget to read my article about why I think Pennsylvania's right to know law is the worst public records law in the nation. I've linked to it below. I've also put a link to a case I'm working on exploreclarion.com, which is me trying to identify the remains of a Jane Doe who was murdered and whose body was found in Clarion County, Pennsylvania by 4 young children in 1990. It's a good series. We have 2 parts up already. I highly recommend it. And with that long-winded outro, I will bid you adieu. And I hope to see you next time. Take care. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please subscribe to my channel. And if you have any comments or questions, please leave them below.